So we move on to the first topic, which is the early determinants of OHSS risk. Is there a role of day 6 estradiol level? So the study background is that the ability to assess the risk of OHSS in an individual subject can help aid management decisions and assist in counseling of patients. And the aim of this study was to assess the early determinants of OHSS risk and whether the cycle day 6 estradiol level predicts the OHSS risk and the freeze all decision in that particular patient. So this was a retrospective data analysis. From January 2003 to January 2014, the records of 24,552 cycles were retrospectively reviewed. A total of 4,536 cycles in which more than 15 oocytes retrieved were included in this study. Then these cycles were divided into three groups. In group one, there was no OHSS development, which included 3,964 cycles. In group two, all patients developed moderate or severe OHSS, that was 387 cycles. And in group three, embryo transfer was canceled due to OHSS risk, which was 185 cycles. Binary multivariate regression analysis was performed to determine significant predictors of OHSS risk. They looked at the age, AMH level, and day 6 E2 levels to find out which of them is a good early predictor of OHSS risk. And according to the regression analysis, age, AMH, and cycle day 6 E2 levels were significant determinants of OHSS risk. However, age was negatively correlated with OHSS risk, and the other parameters were positively correlated. So you can see that if the AMH was equal to or more than 4.5 nanogram per ml, it was a good predictor of OHSS risk, as well as a day 6 E2 level, if it was more than or equal to 400 picograms per ml, again, it was a significant predictor. This again shows us the sensitivity and the specificity of day 6 E2 level as an independent predictor of OHSS risk. And as you can see, that when the day 6 E2 level is more than or equal to 400, you can see that the sensitivity as well as the specificity is very good. So this is the probable cutoff point at which the it acts as a good predictor, independent predictor of OHSS. Similarly, if you look at the level of AMH, here you can see that if the AMH level is more than or equal to 4.5, the sensitivity as well as the specificity is better. So again, this is a type of algorithm which could be used in counseling the patients. Why do we really need to know about the day 6 E2 level and the AMH value? Because you can, early on in the cycle, you can suspect that this particular patient may go into OHSS, and probably you can take a decision to freeze all the embryos at that level, and it could help us in, this type of algorithm could help us in counseling the patients. So the conclusion and the clinical implication of this study is that instead of waiting until HCG day, the data from this study suggests that a freeze-all decision can be given as early as on day 6 based on E2 levels. Age and AMH level also appear to contribute towards making an early decision from the beginning of the cycle. And this would help in counseling patients early in the cycle for freeze-all decision. Clinical implications: patients of younger age, high AMH, and high day 6 E2 levels are at high risk to develop OHSS, so you should be careful and probably counsel them for freezing all the embryos. Then we move on to the next topic. The natural ovarian stimulation, NATOS, successfully combines low estradiol levels and multiple follicle development and may be suitable for fertility preservation in women with estrogen-dependent cancers. one of the problems with women with estrogen dependent cancers who need to undergo IVF is that because of the ovarian stimulation, the estradiol level goes up, which is harmful for them. At the same time, if you give a very low stimulation, you get less oocytes. So we need a protocol where we are able to stimulate the follicles, get more eggs. At the same time, the E2 level doesn't go up. It's a tall order, but this study looks at that, that aspect. So the background is that the supraphysiological E2 levels are unwelcome in fertility preservation candidates with breast cancer. While aromatase inhibitors have been used during controlled ovarian hyperstimulation to avoid hyperestrogenism, serum estrogen levels can still exceed 600 picograms per ml when retrieving numerous oocytes. The aim of this study was to test an innovative controlled ovarian hyperstimulation protocol that virtually curtails endogenous LH levels through use of strong and sustained GnRH antagonist doses while maintaining standard exogenous FSH-only administration. So this was a prospective pilot study of 14 breast cancer patient IVF-ET candidates aged 28 to 38 years. The women volunteered to test efficacy of the NATOS protocol. On day 2 of their menstrual cycle, patients started daily recombinant FSH, the doses fitting antral follicle count subcutaneous, paralleled with daily GnRH antagonist administration. 5 patients received GnRH antagonist 3 mg per day subcutaneous, and 9 patients received 1.5 mg per day subcutaneous. Ovulation triggering with HCG was performed when routine criteria of follicular maturation were met and IVF ET followed. On day of the HCG, the serum E2 levels remained at 343.8 plus minus 170.8 picogram per ml and 333.9 plus minus 175.8 picogram per ml for the 3 milligram and the 1.5 milligram GnRH antagonist groups respectively. Notably, the serum LH levels were undetectable in both groups. Contrasting with the low E2 levels, 16.2 plus minus 7.3 and 8.6 plus minus 4.7 mature oocytes were obtained in the two groups respectively. 11 of the 14 patients achieved a clinical pregnancy, 4 of whom delivered healthy babies, with 7 whose pregnancy continues in good health. So the conclusions and the clinical implications. This pilot study suggests that NATOS may be a unique antagonist COH protocol. NATOS may keep serum E2 levels within the physiological range while maintaining strong follicle production and viable eggs, as reflected by high pregnancy rates. Low E2 levels may help diminish risk for OHSs. And NATOS challenges the hypothesis that sizable LH amounts are required for follicle and oocyte competence. The clinical implications: these findings, if confirmed in further studies, suggest the NATOS protocol may provide a new therapeutic option not only for breast cancer patients seeking fertility preservation, but also in cases in which high estrogenization should be avoided, such as in repeated implantation failures, endometriosis, or previous hormone-dependent cancers. So the summary of the two presentations. The first one, steps should be taken in patients with younger age, high AMH, and high day 6 E2 levels to decrease OHSS development. The second one, these findings, if confirmed in further studies, suggest that NATOS protocol may provide a new therapeutic option, not only for breast cancer patients seeking fertility preservation, but also in cases in which high estrogenization should be avoided, such as in repeated implantation failures, endometriosis, or previous hormone-dependent cancers.